Welcome to Ring of Fire. I'm Mike Papantonio. Today on Ring of Fire, we'll explain how Republican budget cuts have led to massive fraud within the government. We'll also tell you about the latest insurance scams that are driving up the prices for consumers. And we'll talk about the forgotten victims of the Great Recession. We have all that and more coming up. But right now, remember, you just stepped in to the Ring of Fire.
You can't change Washington from the inside. You can only change it from the outside.
Grand jury secrecy rules.
For political gain.
The press can find out.
That has nothing to do with politics, but yeah, go ahead.
It wouldn't bother me.
Oops.
Republicans have tried to bring about the age of austerity. They want to cut the federal budget in nearly every way possible, but these budget cuts aren't saving the government any money. They're actually helping usher in a new era of fraud that cost us more money. Joining me now to talk about this is Michael Burg. Michael, all the austerity freaks that were saying, we got to cut, we got to cut, we got to cut. Now the economists are looking at what has happened. And it's an interesting thing. During the austerity era, when you had every Republican in some what I call blue dog Democrats saying we have to cut more, except we don't want to cut the military spending.
Right.
We don't want to cut spending for ourselves. We want to cut it for everybody else. The criticism was that when you do that, a lot of bad things are going to happen. First of all, the economy is going to completely shut down because it takes money in the system to generate capitalism. And there's another side to this, though, that where we started cutting across the board, we started cutting into organizations that actually help us make money. Explain what happened there.
I think it was bigger than anybody knew. I think this was a plan, Michael. I really do. I think it was a plan to cut the watchdogs, like the IRS. Like the GAO. I mean, those agencies, the SEC, agencies that are out there looking for corruption by these giant corporations or tax cheats. We know that the cuts that occurred between 2010 and 2014 cost the economy in cheaters, in waste, in fraud, over $27 billion. And so the cuts were a small percentage of that. And what it did is it opened the floodgates for people to continue to cheat and make waste of the taxpayers' money. The IRS is another whole deal. Their collection rates decreased in terms of they don't have the people to actually do the audits and to go out and find the tax cheats, the billionaires, the tax cheats. They lost over $17 billion. So,
they lost $17 billion because the IRS didn't have the manpower or the technology to go after. Look, here's the point. If you're a criminal, like some of these, you know, gazillionaire criminals that, you know, they don't pay taxes. Jeez, I mean, you know, what was it? Even Mitt Romney, that we kind of learned about that story with Mitt Romney, where he'd complain about taxes. But at the end of the day, we learned he was only paying 11% taxes. So the IRS now, if you cut the staffing, hold back money on this austerity nonsense from the IRS, they don't have enough agents to go after people like that. And I guess the long run, this is great for if you're a criminal. I saw one figure, Mike. I saw that the IRS has a collection gap right now because they don't have enough people to collect. But there's a collection gap between what should be paid and what's actually paid of something like $380 billion. And you got to know that the people that wrote this legislation to cut their income, they like that.
And I think that was the plan. If America doesn't understand today, with all these ads being put on TV calling everyone liars and cheaters, that the lobbyists and the billionaires, the Koch brothers, they are controlling Washington, the Congress, and the law. This austerity program, in my opinion, was nothing more than a way, you know, to take, you know, to put it in real down-home terms, to take the police department and put them in jail so they can't go out there and catch people robbing the public. That's what they did to the IRS. That's what they did to the SEC. That's what they've done to all kinds of agencies, which are our watchdogs.
Let's spend a little more time on the IRS. For example, when they cut the money to the IRS, the criminals, I mean, these were criminals that understood that we are criminals and we don't want light shining on us. And the people who worked for the criminals were, you know, by de facto criminals themselves. Those are the congressmen and the senators who allowed this to happen. Here's what the senators knew. Unequivocal. History showed it year after year. For every dollar that is included in the overall budget of the IRS, it generates $4 to $5 in additional revenue for our economy. That's what they knew. There was nothing that was completely clear to them when they voted on this, but they voted because their criminal pals said do this. Now, let me ask, because you talk about other issues. You talked about the Office of the Inspector General. This is a great example. The TARP money. You remember when taxpayers paid, you know, like this guy Greenberg, who now is suing the federal government because he got $185 billion in tax money, and he said that wasn't enough. Right. You should have given me more. So he's suing taxpayers. Well, the Office of Inspector General, they have an office that was supposed to look after TARP money. So what happened there?
Well, basically, they didn't have anybody to look after it, and it's disappeared. The money's gone. And the American public, again, is left with the bill. They're sitting out there, again, and I think it's important that the public understand that this is nothing more than the corporations running the government. Fascism. The corporations run the government. They get this kind of austerity program in place, which is not really austerity. As you mentioned, the IRS, a great example, for every dollar you get four back. Same thing with the government overseeing the TARP money. When you get rid of those people, when you don't fund it, then you end up having the criminals and the giant corporations running. They're running the government, and there is no accountability.
We know this from just the TARP affair. We know there's about $4 to $5 billion missing that the inspectors out of the Office of Inspector General, they didn't even have enough staff, literally did not have enough computer capability, didn't have enough audit and review capability to even go after that money. Now, of course, Wall Street loves that. And when congressmen and senators wrote this legislation on austerity, this is the first place they looked. Here's what they found. They cut the combined budgets when this all came up. The combined budgets of all of these inspector general offices by almost $300 million. And they knew they were doing it because they knew if they cut their budget that, by God, they wouldn't find out who the criminals were. But what does this do to us? I mean, if you really think about it, what it does to the Department of Justice, what it does to the Department of just across the board, what does it do to taxpayers? If you really distill what happens here.
It means the taxpayers are continuing to pay for the criminals on their back without any watchdog. You know, people who say, I need a smaller government, I understand that. There are areas that can be cut. But when you cut the IRS, you cut the investigation of the Justice Department, you cut the SEC, you're cutting the places where those are the people who go after the criminals who are cheating, who aren't paying their taxes.
Mike, add to that, the head of the CDC said that you boneheads, and he's basically talking about those boneheads cut the CDC's budget so badly that, A, we weren't able to come up in a timely manner with a solution to Ebola. We could have had an antidote to it. We could have had a vaccine for it, but you cut our budget. B, we don't even have enough people to address the problem that's breaking out in places like Texas. We can't even do anything about that because you boneheads have cut our budget. And then you have the Republicans come back and say, McCain, what an idiot. And McCain's saying, oh, yeah, you don't have any money, but we want to appoint what he calls the Ebola czar. And the head of the CDC is saying, really? Well, really, where are you going to get the money to pay for this czar, Mr. McCain? Because you were the guy that led the attack to cut our budget, McCain in particular.
So, it goes beyond that, Michael, and our listeners should understand. It's all about corporations not paying their tax, their fair tax. Why does the CDC not have enough money? Because we're letting these cheaters go out and find a foreign place. GE, pay no tax. Pfizer, pay no tax. These are billions and billions of dollars which this country needs for the protection of the public from criminals, from Ebola, from all sorts of people out there. And yet, these people now, today, are running on less taxes, trickle down. This
Mike,
country,
it's time to clean the house, and the only way to do it is to come in with independent candidates. You can't count on the Democrats. You can't count on the Republicans anymore. Come in, clean house with independent candidates. I don't see a way around it. Thank you for joining me, Mike.
Thank you, Michael.
The Affordable Care Act was designed to help prevent insurance companies from ripping off consumers. But like we've seen time and time again, the insurance companies have found loopholes that allow them to overcharge patients and to get away with it. Joining me now to talk about the latest insurance industry scam is Howard Nations. Howard, ProPublica did a great investigation on how the insurers are shifting costs to sick people because they're trying to make up money that they feel like they might have lost from healthcare reform. Lay this story out a little bit, if you would. Talk about that ProPublica investigation and what they found in that and what's significant to you about it.
Well, Pap, Obamacare never could have passed without the support of health insurance industry because Obamacare prohibits denying coverage, and it prohibits, it covers people with pre-existing conditions. It prohibits charging more for health insurance coverage, but the insurers signed off on that. But now there's a stealth problem that's been diagnosed by ProPublica, in that the insurers are charging more for drugs for HIV, for diabetes, for epilepsy, Parkinson's, and diseases of that nature, which they're absolutely not supposed to do. The scheme that they're using is, you always had in brand name drugs two categories of expenses. You had the non-preferred drugs, which were more expensive and the insurance companies didn't want to pay for, and they charged a higher copay, and you had the preferred drugs. Now they're doing the same thing with generics. The Affordable Care Act prohibits discriminating against patients with health care problems, but they're now figured out how to shift their cost to the consumers by classifying ailments as non-preferred. So the idea is that patients are supposed to have skin in the game. Patients should have to pay something. So you motivate them to proper use of the drugs, which is the whole idea behind copay. But in an editorial in the American Journal of Managed Care, they ask, how is a patient encouraged if all generics for their disease are non-preferred and cost more? So they're controlling it through the cost of the generics.
So Howard, the people watching this program right now, if they fall into one of these suspect areas, that we know that this is nothing but a hustle. I mean, this is insurance industry again, hustling doctors, hustling patients, stealing in a way that they get their silk stocking lawyers to come down and figure out how to get around things. So now their silk stocking corporate lawyers say, well, that's real easy. If somebody's dying from Parkinson's disease, or if they're dying from HIV or things like diabetes, just put them in a certain class and try to make it look like we're not dealing with that we're not treating them differently because of pre-existing problem. Just say they're classed different, therefore they have to pay five times as much for drugs that the person next to them pays, and that they have to pay out of their pocket to make that happen. Isn't that kind of what in simplest terms, isn't that the new scam by the insurance industry?
That is the new scam, and it was recognized by Wayne Turner, who's an attorney with the National Law Health Law Program. He calls it a race to the bottom. Here's the other thing they're doing. They're trying to set up their plans, which because they can't deny coverage for pre-existing conditions. So what they're trying to do now is construct their plans in such a way that they would be onerous to sick people to discourage them from enrolling in their plans, hence the race to the bottom. So their technique is to provide no preferred cheaper alternative. You have cheaper alternatives in brand name drugs. They're providing no preferred cheaper alternative in the generic drugs. And in July, 300 patient groups complained to Health and Human Services that these health plans are circumventing the spirit of Obamacare by excessive copays and having nothing but non-preferred plans, no cheaper choice.
So, but now we have a U.S. Supreme Court majority that, of course, that are going to support the insurance industry on this and probably say, gee whiz, you can't bring a class action against them. You're going to have to mediate. And in the mediation, explain what's going to happen there.
Well, in mediation, we know what's going to happen. They're going to go with the insurance industry. What's happened here is brand names, this is amazing because in this case, the brand name drugs are the ones doing it right. They lose patient protection. It typically, they lose patent protection when it and becomes generic. Generally, generics are cost $5 to $10, and there were no tiers in generics. The trick now is that they put this higher copay in with non-preferred. There was a study done on this. It was a totally stealth operation until it was discovered by a vice president of policy analysis who went in to get his own copay. He'd been getting the same drug for years at $5. All of a sudden, it's costing him $20 copay. He did an investigation. He found out, perhaps, that this thing was so stealth that it was unknown to even the health policy experts. So the problem is that with the non-preferred drugs, they can pay copay of $10 to $15 more. And studies have shown that $1 difference in the cost of a drug can alter the behavior of patients. $10 to $15 difference is huge.
Yeah, in other words, they don't take their medication.
Right.
What about the doctor out there? Okay, you got doctor. The doctor's trying to treat somebody for diabetes. And then they're saying, well, in order to be treated for diabetes, you've got to do something. You've got to take your meds. And so they say the insurance company won't let them get the meds without a 5 times the normal markup for those meds. So they don't take them. Doesn't this put pressure on the doctor to say, look, insurance company, you're telling me that I have a benchmark of results that I have to get, and you're interfering right with my ability to get those benchmarks. Talk about that part of the story a little bit. It's amazing to me.
Well, this has always been a fascinating part of the story in that the insurance industry is now running the healthcare industry, and this is a fine example of it. Dr. Mark Fendick, who's at the University of Michigan, who specializes in value-based insurance design, says that this whole scheme of generic drugs with just non-preferred category is counter to this value-based strategy. Under this strategy now, the insurance companies are paying doctors for patient outcome. So if you have a diabetes doctor, he's paid based upon the blood sugar levels of his patients. They say if you are charging more for generics and that extra $5 or $10 on the prescription drug causes the patients to skip their drugs, then their conditions worsen. When they come back in to see the doctor, they get bad results. The doctors, therefore, are paid less on this value-based outcome. And this is what occurs when you have no preferred, cheaper alternatives. It's amazing. The insurance industry is absolutely running the medical profession.
Yeah, and the insurance industry in that case that you just described, they win on both sides.
Yeah.
Because the doctor can't raise to the level that they're demanding under their benchmark because the patients aren't taking the medication because the insurance company
right
is charging so damn much for the medication. And the insurance company knows full well, they know the statistics that you just talked about. They understand the statistics are very clear that just $1, you almost start having a mass exodus if you increase their medication. But when you get up to 5 or 6 times the amount simply because somebody has HIV or diabetes or Parkinson's disease, you know, again, until somebody goes to prison, until we start seeing these cats in striped uniforms in prison, nothing really changes. And man, you could round them up in the insurance industry. It would be very easy
to get a whole
busload of criminals.
You really could.
Howard Nations, thank you for joining me. These stories get more interesting as we watch Obamacare develop. We're going to find all kinds of scams like this. Thanks for joining me.
My pleasure, Pap.
You may not think that vehicle recalls are a problem for you, but the truth is that unsafe vehicles on the road are putting all of our lives at risk. While other countries are working to make vehicles safer, our elected officials have refused to take action, even as the amount of recalls continue to increase. Joining me now to talk about that is David Haynes. David, the American Prospect did a great article talking about how we have these ticking time bombs by the way of defective automobiles that have been recalled but are still on the road, and they're all over the place. Lay this story out for us a little bit.
Well, as your viewers well know, there have been an astonishing number of recalls, particularly this year, beginning with the GM ignition defect and a number of other manufacturer problems. And it's now to the point where one in every six cars on the road is actually subject to a recall. Many of these recalls, consumers are not bringing their cars in, and the manufacturers aren't seeing to it that the problems are fixed, the problems that they created and sold and put on the road. So it's an incredible safety hazard on our road. Roadways.
How bad are some of the defects?
Well, it's very serious. In the case of GM with the ignition defect, 2.6 million of those vehicles have that problem. And GM has admitted that about 13 or 14 fatalities and 50 some other injuries have resulted from that. The true numbers are much higher.
What happens with that defect, David? What happens? Explain to the viewers what happens with ignition defect.
What happens in that situation, it involved a small ignition coil. And essentially, a number of things can happen. If you drive over a rough road, the car can just cut off because the key comes out. A lot of people have a lot of things hanging off of their keychain or a heavy keychain, and that can pull the key out of the ignition, and then the car is still running, but you have no steering power, no control, and the airbags don't work. So a lot of terrible problems.
So with that, GM, first of all, they lied about it for years, didn't tell anybody. They knew the problem. So they do a recall. And isn't part of the recall problem that the reason some people don't respond is even when they get the recall letter, it's kind of milquetoast. You know, it is like, well, you know, you got this problem, bring it in when you can, rather than having alert and, you know, this is dangerous and something that really is an attention getter. So people don't bring their cars in. Isn't that kind of problem?
You're absolutely right. It's very different than Europe. These letters are very milquetoast. So they don't say, you know, urgent. It's just like, hey, here's another recall. And frankly, a lot of the consumers on the road, there have been so many recalls, they're sort of becoming immune to them. And also, these are not mandatory recalls. In our country, it's up to the consumer to bring the vehicle in. A lot of times, they don't understand the urgency of it. And so, therefore, we have millions of cars on the road where the recalls are still out there. It's inconvenient to bring them in, but they can still continue to register these vehicles and drive them around, even though this is an urgent, you know, safety matter.
Well, I think that the thing that's most upsetting is it's not about just them. I mean, it's about causing other accidents out on the road because they're too damn lazy or not just too uninformed to take their car in. Or the other side of it is, you know, you got people riding in your car. You know, you have your children, your family riding in your car, and you don't have enough sense, or you haven't been put on good enough notice to take your car back in.
Absolutely. And a number of people have been a victim of these defects, but they don't even know it. As you say, if you were involved in a head-on collision and the other vehicle crossed the double yellow, it wasn't your vehicle, you don't know. We advise consumers and families out there to look into this. Contact an attorney, contact a government agency. If you or your family, loved one, has been involved in a serious accident with a GM or other vehicle, you need to check and see. Maybe the other vehicle was involved in a recall, because it's not only those who are riding in your vehicle, it's any of other vehicles that are on the roadway are posing an extreme hazard.
What do other countries do, David, when the recall letter goes out and they said, we've got a defective product, and the owner of the automobile says, well, you know, I just don't have the time to go get this checked out, or I don't want to mess with it, or, you know, it's never going to happen to me. What do they do in other countries when the individual refuses to take the car back?
Well, in Germany and other countries in Europe, it's mandatory. The registration will not be renewed if the car is under a recall notice. And of course, our country is not like that. It's very different. We do have certain states here in the District of Columbia, California, other places that have emission standards, of course. And if you don't meet the emission standard, then you can't renew the registration. And so many advocates for reform in this area have been calling for that to be implemented in our country. And it makes a lot of sense that if your car is under at least one of the more urgent recall notices, such as the ignition defect, a tire retread problem that we had with Bridgestone, that you need to get that fixed before you can register the vehicle, and that will go a long way to saving lives.
So in the U.S., as you point out, so you got about 40 million recalls that go out, just incredible numbers of recalls. When we compare the quality of the work that's being done here, it results in these recalls. It's 40 million recalls, and out of that, you have about 40% of the drivers that never even respond to it. So you got 40% of that 40 million still out on the road with defective steering, defective brakes, defective ignition, defective fuel systems, and they're, you know, it's almost like they don't care. It's almost like, well, it's not my problem, even though they have their family riding around in that car.
Yeah, the focus needs to be on the manufacturer and the situation with the ignition defect. They knew of the problem, as you said. They covered it up. They changed the part, but not the part number, which made it much harder to track. And it's just a culture of cover-up. It's expensive to do these recalls, and so you have a systemic culture in these big auto corporations in Detroit and elsewhere that they don't want to take responsibility. They're just putting their head in the sand and hoping the problem goes away. So we need to insist on safety. There are much better records with the German manufacturers and so forth, and America needs to lead the way in putting safe products on the road and safe vehicles.
Yeah, but here we've got a situation where a consumer says, look, I don't want to repair. The comparison over, say, in Germany is it's mandatory. If you don't bring your car in and you have gotten, they call them alerts. It's not some milquetoast kind of letter that sends out where you read it, you don't even know that anything's really wrong. It's an alert, and they're told, take your car in now. And if they don't take their car in and they're caught driving without the repair, first of all, it's huge fines. And second of all, they don't even renew registration. The individual's not allowed to drive that car, which is kind of the way it should be. I mean, when some people are so brain dead that they don't understand the significance of it, or the manufacturer tries to make it sound like it's not as important as you think, that's where we get into trouble. You know, I was wondering, what about rental cars? I mean, you know, you go, you rent a car, you think, surely these cars have been complied with for recalls. What's the record on that?
Well, absolutely. This is another situation where Congress really provides a lot of favoritism to the rental car industry. You have big business. They're lobbying up on the Hill. This is one of the examples. We've seen other favoritism, recent reform and legislation passed in favor of rental car companies on liability. And this is yet another example. If you go rent a car, would you think that they're not permitted to rent a car that's been recalled? You would think so, but you'd be wrong. There is no law requiring rental car companies to not rent a car which has been subject to recall. Now, thanks to pressure due to outside groups, they have made a pledge not to do that, over 90% of the car companies, but that's just voluntary, and it doesn't have the effect of law. And so that certainly is an area that should be changed.
Yeah, I mean, there's stories, a horrible story as I read not long ago, where two young ladies, they go rent, they rent a rental car. I think it was a Chrysler PT Cruiser, and they were having problems with them catching on fire. And sure enough, this one catches on fire. It doesn't only kill the people in the cruiser, but it causes them to careen across the median and almost kill an entire family on the other side of that median. So I think it's a two-part problem here. One is consumers need to damn sure wake up and understand they have responsibility, not just to themselves. They can't be lazy. They have responsibility to their family and other people out on the road, and certainly manufacturers and rental car companies of all people. My God, can you imagine not having any responsibility to say, hey, oh, by the way, this has been recalled. David Haynes, thank you for joining me. It's a story that Congress doesn't seem much interested in doing anything about. Thanks.
Thank you, Pat.
It's been 5 years since the policies of the Bush administration helped bring about the Great Recession. And while things are looking better under Obama, there's still plenty of economic victims out there who aren't getting the help or even the recognition from this administration that they deserve. There's still too much suffering among the working class, and I have Joshua Holland from BillMoyers.com with me to tell us about the forgotten victims of the Great Recession. You know, Josh, if you pick up the headlines these days, it looks like the Great Recession is over. Everything's fine. Everybody's just hunky-dory. A car in every garage, two chickens in every pot. You know, you almost feel like that's the message out there. It's far from the truth, though, isn't it?
Well, it really is. I mean, look, there's legitimately good economic news. We've seen rapid job growth. But the thing is that there's a huge number of people that are basically the forgotten victims of the recession. And that's the long-term unemployed. We have 3 million people who have been unemployed for 6 months or more. A good share of them have been unemployed for 2 years or more. And the thing is, Pap, they have really unique challenges for getting back into the workforce. So, you know, if you're out of job for 6 weeks or, you know, 2 months, you haven't lost the skills, and you're not rusty. You're still able to go out and present yourself in a confident manner in a job interview. When you're unemployed for a very long time, it comes with all sorts of problems, emotional problems, psychological problems. But the biggest problem is that companies discriminate against the long-term unemployed. And there's been a number of studies which show that, you know, if you send fake resumes to companies and you have them, and these fake resumes are identical in every way, similar names, you know, they suggest the same ethnicity, same experience, same skills. If one of them has a long gap in unemployment, they're much less likely to get a call back.
It's almost as if HR departments in various companies have taken a look at what does it mean to be long-term unemployed. As you point out, what does it do to their abilities? Their abilities become soft. They suffer from depression. They suffer from a whole host of anxiety issues because a lot of these people have been unemployed for 5-6 years. And it's not that they're applying. I mean, I saw something besides the article that you wrote that, by the way, was a great article, The Forgotten Victims of the Great Recession. I saw another article that talked about the fact that they apply and they apply, and it's not that they don't apply for jobs. I think about a dozen in this piece were followed, and it showed that they were doing everything they were supposed to do. But there was this element that you just talked about the employer saying, I don't know, you've been out of work for 3 years. I don't know if you're damaged goods or not. Isn't that kind of the problem here?
I mean, that's a huge, huge piece of it, and it creates a vicious cycle, because if you're doing everything that you're supposed to do, as you say, if you send dozens and hundreds of resumes out, you know, hundreds of cover letters, and you never get a response because companies are discriminating against you, you're then more likely to drop out of the workforce entirely and just give it up. You know, there's other issues at play. When we've seen people laid off with foreclosure issues, et cetera, a lot of their credits are destroyed. And with companies increasingly running credit scores, this is another form, you know, it's not just direct discrimination, but here's an indirect barrier to getting back into the workforce. If your credit is shot, you're going to have a lot of problems with a lot of employers.
What we see happening, and you talked about this in your article, The Forgotten Victims of the Great Recession, is that there's actually, and we've seen this underground economy develop in bad economic times in the past, all the way back to the Great Depression. I mean, one vast, vast underground economy that's developed. We see people moving into that underground economy, don't we? I think the number that you talked about was there's $2 trillion kicking around out in just this thing called the underground economy, where people are just trying to make ends meet.
That's right. Now, you know, it's important to understand that when you're talking about the long-term unemployed, their unemployment benefits have run out, right? If you're not a parent of a child, it's almost impossible to get welfare benefits, no matter what your income level, in many, many states. So I was talking to my editor about this piece, and she said, well, what do these people do? And what they do is whatever they need to do to survive. So that's a varied, you know, a lot of different routes. Some people are collecting cans to turn in for a recycling center. Some people have to turn to crime. It's a big mess, but that's the underground economy, people doing whatever they can to make ends meet.
How is it that the narrative on this story has become things are great now? How is it that have we just become so numb to the idea of how bad things are? I mean, isn't part of it that we have to be honest about where we are right now, don't we?
I think it's because a lot of these people are working in in the shadow. So if you're talking about your typical, you know, economic reporter, they probably don't know a lot of people in this situation. So they're looking at the headline numbers. And as I said at the beginning, we have had some pretty good headline job growth numbers. So I think that this is why I called them the forgotten victims of the recession. I think that they're largely out of sight, out of mind. I have a friend who's been in this position. He's been out of work now for almost 5 years. He's one of those that small number that's really, really, really been out of a job for a very long time, and he is despondent, right? So he's not going and protesting and doing things to make himself look more visible. He's basically withdrawn. He's dealing with serious depression, and as you mentioned, mental health issues go hand in hand with this.
One thing that we've seen progressives talking about, and it's almost as if we certainly Blue Dog Democrats don't understand it. Republicans certainly don't understand it. They're paid not to understand it. And I sometimes scratch my head and I wonder whether Obama understands that if you don't have money in the system, if from the very top, if you can't fuel capitalism to where it reaches the very bottom, there is no way to solve these last millions of people who are unemployed. You got to have systems to where you don't have banks holding on to trillions and trillions of dollars, unwilling to spread that money out. Capitalism dies, and this is one of the offshoots of it, isn't it?
I couldn't agree more. There's direct and indirect ways that is holding back the recovery for this last group. You know, we've seen if you look at total jobs, the private sector has completely recovered from the Great Recession. What's holding us back in the labor market is cuts to the public sector employment. And then if you look, and I mentioned this in the piece, there are things that we could be doing to help these people transition into the workforce again, and there just isn't the budgets for it. I mean, these are things that need public and private partnerships. And they've been proven effective in small scale. I mentioned a pilot program in Connecticut that's helped a couple of hundred long-term unemployed people get back into the labor market. But we need to be doing that on a large scale at the federal level, and we're not doing it.
Well, there has to be a will to have it done. And right now, I think, as you point out in your piece, there seems to be a lack of will at the congressional level. You've got a few people out there who seem to give a damn. Harry Reid, for example, trying to renew unemployment benefits. But, you know, for the most part, it's not in their backyard. They really don't care. And that is typical of the type of Congress that we've had for so long now. Thank you, Joshua, for joining me, okay?
Thanks, Pat.
Joshua Holland is the senior digital producer for BillMoyers.com. In American society, it's always been common for doctors to make a good living for themselves. They typically spend a decade in school, years in internships, and then they end up being on call for 24 hours a day. But there are a few doctors out there who feel they deserve more money for doing less work, and this is a phenomenon that's unique to America in a lot of ways. Joining me now to talk about the culture of greed in our medical profession is Dr. Tom Schneider, author of the book, A Physician's Apology. Dr. Schneider, you've been a medical doctor for how many years now?
Oh, you would ask that, Pap, wouldn't you? I'm going to say 40 years, yeah.
Okay, And in 40 years, had you ever heard the term drive-by doctor until just recent years, this term drive-by doctor? What in the hell is that?
You know, I really have not heard that term. Honest to goodness, none of that was around. Doc in the box was never around. You know, in my year, it was Dr. Welby was the goal. The people who are listening won't know but the family doc.
Tell us what's happening with the drive-by doc scam that's taken place. It's not just doctors, it's staff, it's any attendant care of every kind. Tell us how this works and how patients sometimes, well, most of the time, really get hustled on this whole thing.
I will. And I will preface it by saying this really sets me up so well in the medical community. My doctors are going to just love me.
Doctor, you would agree, it's not all medical professionals that we see doing this. It seems to me when you look at it, it's really heavy emphasis in big cities, large hospitals, we're billing, people live or die by billing. But tell us what happens. How does this whole thing work?
Well, it's actually an amazing story. It's a history, Mike, in that you're absolutely right. It's a small percentage of physicians who do this, and nobody really has a number on it. But the staggering facts are the number of errors from a billing standpoint that occur, both from the physician standpoint and the hospital standpoint. A young gal by the name of Sparrow at Harvard has determined that the figure is about 80% of all hospital bills and medical bills have an error in them. Small percentage of people, and I would agree it's in the larger cities that it happens, but it is, I think, much more pervasive than we know, not just in medicine, but as you and I talked about just prior, it really is sort of the nip of the entire nation, isn't it? I mean, it's in law, it's in police, it's in education.
Well, okay, but look, doctor, with this, what I'm trying to get at is here you have if I understand this story, you have a patient in an emergency room laying on a gurney.
Right.
Okay. The way this works is there are doctors that should be working on that patient. Mm-hmm. But then there are other healthcare professionals that simply stop by, and then all of a sudden their bill shows up with the insurance company, or if the insurance company won't pay it, the patient has to pay it. And they're just literally just moving by the patient. They say 10 words, they take a look, take a temperature, and all of a sudden there's another $1,000. Did I get that right? Is that what this issue is about?
I think that's an excellent example, but it's far more pervasive than that. I was in the hospital for 4 months, 2 years ago, on a monitor, meaning my heart is being monitored continually. I was given 2 EKGs a day. Absolutely no reason for that, no validity whatsoever, but it was being done. And the process of multiple physicians, multiple paramedical personnel coming in and then being billed by the hospital, very, very, very common. I think one of the more prominent techniques is also something called unbundling. And for the audience, let me explain that that means if you're going in to have a global procedure, you're going to have a gallbladder exploratory surgery, removal of stones, and look at your liver, for example. All of those are bundled into one package, and there's a price. It's not $100, but let's call it $100. That's for all of those things to be done. Well, it's very easy for the hospital or the physician to unbundle that. So he bills for each individual aspect of that procedure. And the bill is now not $100, but it's $5,000. And it's literally that big of a difference.
Doc, the thing that seems to be driving up a lot of the prices is it's almost a greed factor. I don't know how else you can put it.
No, absolutely.
You've got a hospital. You've got an individual in the hospital. They have what they call the in-network doctor. In other words, who is the doctor that's removing the gallbladder, as you point out? And then all of a sudden, you have this big influx of out-of-network doctors, passerbys, nurses, that do things that really don't fit into what needs to be done, but they nevertheless bill the patient anyway.
Absolutely.
Is that something that you've seen over the years and 40
years
practicing?
It's not only something I've seen, Mike, but it's something that I've seen increasing. And there's a learned pattern here of how to bill. For example, if I'm admitted to the ICU, which I was, I'm billed for the time I'm in the ICU. I'm also billed for the respirator that was used in the ICU, even though the bill for the ICU includes a respirator. So they're actually double billing. But I wouldn't know that unless I, as a patient, demanded an itemized bill. I want to see why that Band-Aid cost $24.
Okay, so isn't part of the problem, I mean, for example, if you got an orthopedic doctor that used to be making $700,000 a year, now Obamacare changes that, now he's making $500,000 a year. Don't we expect to see this a lot more, this what I call out-of-network drive-by doctoring take place, where all of a sudden bills start increasing, the patient's laying there thinking, oh, man, this is great, all these people really care for me. Yeah. And but as each one of them comes by, that new bill, it just gets bigger and bigger and bigger. Don't we expect to see that a lot more now?
That's not only a fact, but what a scary truth, isn't it, Michael? That's really what we're dealing with. You know, the old phrase of water quenches thirst, food quenches hunger, but there's not enough gold to quench greed. And that's unfortunately what it comes down to. It's my profession, but I have to stand here and say there is an enormous amount of greed because of the cutbacks that have occurred in medical funding. Nonetheless, as a quick add, we are the highest paid physicians in the world. Know that now.
I saw some business. It was called the Business of Spine. I thought this was incredible. But it's an organization that goes around the country telling doctors how to increase their billing. The company does. How to change coding, how to be innovative, how to generate new money. Are you familiar with that?
Absolutely. There's not one. There are multiple companies like that springing up all over. Oh, absolutely.
So if you got companies going around telling doctors how they can make more money by doing things that are questionable, I mean, we know the end of that story, don't we?
You already do. And it really comes down to things that you and I have talked about so many times. What's the right thing to do? Where's the ethics involved here? And unfortunately, because greed is so pervasive, I mean, it's a disease. It's affluenza is what I call it. Affluenza. It's a need to be affluent. Because it's so prevalent, you really almost need to institute a supervening, overseeing body from an ethics standpoint.
Yeah, well, let's hope we can move that way. Dr. Tom Schneider, thank you for joining me, okay?
Love it always, Mike. Thanks.
Florida is one of the most important swing states in the country, and conservative money men have been trying to swing the state in favor of Republicans for a very long time. The first step in making this happen was to install a corporate fraudster as our governor. But there's a lot more to Rick Scott's story, a story that corporate media isn't telling. I have Farron Cousins from the Trial Lawyer magazine here to tell us how Florida wound up with a criminal as their governor and how we're now regarded as the new Mississippi where it comes to politics. Farron, Rick Scott, what an indictment of Florida voters. I mean, really, if you think about it, has Florida just become the new Mississippi?
It really has. You know, you take Rick Scott, a guy who was too corrupt for a state like Texas, too corrupt for the state that gave us George W. Bush, Tom DeLay, Rick Perry. They send him over to Florida, and voters just embrace him like crazy, forgetting the fact that, you know, this guy should be in prison right now. If he was an average citizen or an average CEO, he would be in prison right now, most likely. And it all goes back, if you think about 2004, 2005, actually, you had Howard Dean, chairman of the DNC, said, Democrats, you need to come up with a 50-state strategy. You need to stop focusing all of your attention on the big national races and go to the state level, go to the local level. Well, the Democratic establishment balked at it. They said, no, we're going to keep focusing our attention where we think it's important. But you know who was paying attention? Was people like the Koch brothers. And that's how we came about with a guy like Rick Scott. They knew.
Explain to the viewers what it is that the Koch, I mean, we know in a sense why the Koch brothers love Rick Scott. I mean, first of all, he is a criminal, and criminals kind of, they'll kind of do what you ask them to do when you ask them to do it. But Dick, talk about that Koch brother relationship. Most people don't know.
Well, you know, this is not one of those hyperbole like, oh, it's the Koch brothers behind it. The Koch brothers have fully been behind Rick Scott since early 2010. They saw in him what they see in themselves. He turns a blind eye to criminal activity, self-made multimillionaire, doesn't even need the Koch money, and that's one thing that they like. But he's also a completely blank slate in terms of, you know, ideas as a politician. They tell him what to do, and he does it. And so what they did was they saw him come from Texas with this criminal past, sent him over to Florida, fueled him with talking points, gave him a little bit of money, and they said, here's what you got to do. They ramped up the Tea Party down there in South Florida, and those are the people who really, really embraced Rick Scott. And so since he's been in office, he has done everything that the Koch brothers have wanted him to do. He's loosened regulations for oil companies. He's allowed them to go, you know, start drilling and fracking in the Everglades. We have projects up in North Florida where fracking is about to commence. And so you really can't say that, you know, Rick Scott and the Koch brothers have been separated from each other, because they're operating together essentially to bring down the state of Florida, and they're doing a pretty good job of it right now.
Well, I mean, you know, if you travel around the country right now, there's almost a laugh factor about Florida. When I say it has become the new Mississippi or the new Alabama, that's not hyperbole. There's this notion that we've become so disconnected from reality that we have a Rick Scott and we have a Marco Rubio because we simply don't keep up. If you line up 10 people right now and ask them, did you know that Rick Scott stole $1.7 billion, more than that, from Medicaid, from basically elderly people and disabled people through their company? I'd be surprised if three of them even know about it. And the onslaught has been constant. What's the difference now? You've got Charlie Crist out there talking about all of this, but what's the difference between why people may listen now and they didn't listen last time?
Well, last time, Rick Scott poured in tens of millions of dollars of his own personal money to control the message. He got ahead of it before his challenger could make it an issue. And his challenger at the time, a woman named Alex Sink, not a bad candidate, just didn't have that attack that we needed. So Rick Scott came out in 2010 and he owned his fraud before she could make it an issue. He said, look, here's what happened. Yeah, my company did it, but I was the CEO and I knew nothing about it. I am totally in the right. This is a dead issue. Let's move on. And so the voters did. But Charlie Crist now in 2014 has come out and said, no, this is not a dead issue. I think people need to understand what you, Mr. Scott, did as the CEO of this Columbia HCA. And what they did, as you pointed out, they were stealing from Medicare and Medicaid, but they were illegally changing the codes on services performed on patients. You know, perhaps somebody went in, let's just say, they hurt their wrist, but instead they'll mark it up as, oh, they broke their arm and we had to reset a bone. Those are
just
the
complete
kinds
fraud
of little...
just straight out fraud is what you're describing. In other words,
right,
they have a system. If it comes in, say, sprained wrist, classified as a broken arm, and the upcharge is going to be hundreds and hundreds of dollars difference, and they caught them doing that on thousands of cases. The numbers I've heard out there as high as $3 billion worth of money that they stole. But what I find remarkable is that Rick Scott somehow walked away from that, even though there were people at the company resigning because of it, even though people at the company said, yes, I knew about it, and so did Rick Scott. And so he gets the protection of the Constitution. He pleads the Fifth Amendment 75 times, and nobody goes to jail. And that ends up serving as governor of the state of Florida. And
right,
we look like, in Florida, look like a bunch of damn dummies.
Absolutely. And, you know, Rick Scott, he did resign as soon as the FBI came knocking on their door to say, hey, whoa, we've got all of these documents that show that you guys are committing this massive fraud. Rick Scott did resign. He jumped ship. He headed, you know, the company was located in Texas. That's where the fraud occurred. John Cornyn over there kind of swept it all under the rug for him. So he hightails it out of Texas, comes to Florida, goes into venture capital, makes a couple hundred million there, and decides to run for governor at the
he makes that money with the money that he stole from Medicaid and Medicare through HCA. That's what's
right,
so ugly about it.
Right.
Okay, let me ask you this, Farron. It appears that the reports coming out of the Scott camp right now are they're terrifying for the Scott supporters, and that is that no matter how much money they spend, they can't get Rick Scott's favorables to come up at all. His favorables are something akin to ISIS and maybe Ebola,
right,
and so they can't move those favorables. And the unfavorables remain high. They're higher than Charlie Crist. So don't we expect there just to be an onslaught attack of Charlie Crist to try to get his unfavorables up? Isn't that kind of textbook politics?
It would seem so. And that's exactly what Charlie Crist is doing right now. That's why he's brought this Columbia HCA issue back into the spotlight. But if we go back during Rick Scott's tenure, his unfavorables are actually not even from the Columbia HCA fraud. His unfavorables are coming from his relentless attacks on the teachers' unions, his decision to not accept funds for the high-speed rail down in South Florida, and just his overall budget cuts to education.
How many jobs did that cost? It was thousands of jobs
it cost
by... And the Koch brothers asked him, the Koch brothers are the ones that said, please don't do that.
Right.
And the Koch brothers were the ones that ordered him to kill that high-speed rail, and of course he did it because
exactly.
he's owned by
and
the Koch
because that rail would have traveled over areas that they want to drill for oil in, that they want to go frack. And they can't do that if you've got a high-speed rail going right through the middle of it. So that's one of the reasons they killed it. It also would have been, you know, a very heavy union job with all the constructions. They don't want that. They want private companies to come in and build a rail if there's going to be one. Privatize everything. And that, again, is what they've done with education. They're taking public funds. Rick Scott is taking public funds set for public education, taxpayer dollars, and instead he's sending those to private schools, privatized schools. And that's another reason
doing the same thing with prisons as well.
Trying exactly.
to his goal. He's been ordered by the Koch brothers to privatize virtually everything they can, as all of the Republican governors have been ordered around when they get Koch brother money. Farron Cousins, this is an interesting. It's going to be an interesting election. Thank you for joining me. Hopefully, somebody will start paying attention to the fact that we have a criminal as a governor, and it's affecting. It's affecting our reputation as a state in general. When we're classified as the new Mississippi, that's pretty scary. Farron Cousins, thank you.
Thank you.
That's it for this week's Ring of Fire, but you can keep up with us throughout the week online at ringoffireradio.com or on Twitter at Ring of Fire Radio and on Facebook. I'm Mike Papantonio. We'll see you next week right here on Ring of Fire.